I'm Roger Ebert, film critic of the Chicago Sun-Times.
And I'm Gene Siskel, film critic of the Chicago Tribune.
That's my family, Katie. It's not me.
Oh, but it is him. And there it is, from young and handsome Al Pacino to a barely recognizable Diane Keaton, the key line of dialogue in Francis Coppola's masterpiece, The Godfather, now being reissued next week with a brand new print and sparkling soundtrack in honor of its 25th anniversary. It's the key line because Michael Corleone doesn't know the power of his own family. It's a big part of him, too. The big surprise for me, seeing The Godfather again, is just how great Al Pacino is in this picture. Marlon Brando, of course, gained the notoriety and the Oscar, but Pacino provides even more glue to hold the story together.
Now, Johnny is my father's godson, and my father went to see this family. Now, he offered him $10,000 to let Johnny go, but the band leader said no. So the next day, my father went to see him, only this time with Luca Brasi. And within an hour, he signed a release for a certified check of $1,000.
How'd he do that?
My father made him an offer he couldn't refuse.
Later, he takes control from his wounded father and replaces the loyal consigliere Tom Hagen, his adopted brother, played magnificently by Robert Duvall.
You're not a wartime consigliere, Tom. Things may get rough with the move we're trying.
Still later, in a great scene, Michael Corleone moves his family's interests from New York to Las Vegas, and he's foolishly put his irresponsible older brother Fredo, the late great John Cazale, in charge. But Fredo, the goof, greets Michael with hookers, and it's a big mistake.
Who are the girls?
That's for you to find out.
Get rid of them, Fredo.
Hey, Mike.
Fredo, I'm here on business. I leave tomorrow and I get rid of them.
Of course, I can't leave out Marlon Brando. A great moment. His death scene, improvised by Brando himself. The Godfather is glorious drama, high art, and high entertainment, from Gordon Willis's magnificent interior camera work to the perfectly oily performance of the sleazy Mo Green by Alex Rocco, to the unexpected trip to Sicily, where Michael hides out. They got the money to shoot that sequence. We never saw anything like that in a mob picture before. Mm-hmm. The Godfather is about how justice denied soon becomes justice subverted. That's how the film is opening, with the baker's appeal to the Don. I could talk for hours about the film, but, you know, it's Roger's show, too. You know it's excellent. It's worth another look on the big screen. No new footage, but a beautiful, pristine print available nationwide next Friday.
You know, looking at the film again, and I agree, of course, with everything you've said, I realized how it works, because oddly enough, in this movie, The Godfather represents good, and the Godfather theme is sad because people didn't listen to The Godfather. If they'd only listened to Don Vito, we could have saved all this trouble and all these dead bodies. And the reason they get away with that, it's so brilliant in this story by Mario Puzo and Francis Ford Coppola, it's a sealed system. Right. There are no civilians. The only cop you meet is McCluskey. He's crooked.
He's in there.
There are no victims. You don't see any victims of gambling and alcohol and prostitution and then later drugs.
Right.
And the only crime is disloyalty.
Right.
And so within the sealed moral world of this film, everything works and he's the good guy.
This is the rare case of where a book, and it was a pop culture book, has been transfigured by Coppola into something far greater than that.
Well, let's... Now, it is pop culture, but I read The Godfather, and I couldn't put it down. It's just a heck of a good story.
But you know that this is a greater movie than it is a book.
Well, that goes without saying. When we come back...
I said it.
Well, then you said it. Okay, and I agree.
My next choice of a commercially unsuccessful movie that is now available on cassette, and I think it's worth running, is Francis Coppola's wildly underrated The Conversation, a 1974 picture about a great wiretapper played by Gene Hackman, who's been doing his job and doing it brilliantly for years until he realizes that he's a stooge, actually, for other people's often nefarious plans. Early in the film, he and the late great actor John Cazale, Fredo from The Godfather, listen to a recording they're making of a young couple in a San Francisco park.
Pay attention to your recordings.
Coming in loud and clear.
Look, you see him? The man with the hearing aid, like Charles.
Where?
Right there with the shopping bag.
Well, that's it for Paul. I spotted him.
Give me the phones.
He's been following us all around. He's following us close.
It's nothing. Don't worry about it.
That's a brilliant scene, and it reflects what's so good in this movie. It plays as absolutely real. Hackman's performance is his best of all time. I think it's as good as his one in The French Connection. Better, maybe. And he is playing here an emotionally burnt-out case, and we feel very sad for him. And the film displays, in all of its treachery, the absolute horror of invading another person's thoughts and conversations. How dare they listen in to this innocent couple? This is a great movie, and I just want to credit one more person who worked on it. The sound engineer, Walter Murch. A brilliant job, and sound engineering in this film is key to what makes it work so well.
And of course, you said, how dare they eavesdrop on this innocent couple, but of course, one of the mysteries is whether or not they're
innocent. That is correct.
We think they are. The nice thing about this movie is that, like The Jagged Edge, which was not nearly as good a movie as The Conversation,
not at all.
It takes the hero and puts him in a position at the beginning where he thinks that he's running things, just as the lawyer in Jagged Edge, she thinks she's running things, and then finds out that things are happening that are totally outside of their control, and they don't have any idea by the end of
what's right,
what's wrong, who they can trust, who they can't trust. And following Hackman, as he gradually just goes absolutely paranoid with fear,
that's correct,
is fascinating.
Roger, I saw this after I had just returned from a trip to Russia in January of 1974. Yeah. And you know, on occasion I'm told eavesdropping is done in Russia.
Mm-hmm.
When I saw this film, I had such a reaction of the sanctity of not listening in on other people and not invading other people. This film chilled me to the bone. It's 12 years now, okay? I still remember that
feeling. It's a great movie to look at on video because it's so complicated that you have this tendency to want to stop, reverse, and look at something again to see if you really heard what you thought you heard.
Okay, my selection is Francis Coppola's The Conversation with Gene Hackman in his best performance on film, and that too is saying a lot. Now, recently I ran into Hackman, who was visiting Chicago for a weekend, and I told him our idea for this show, and it really pleased him. He said that these films from the early 70s sometimes weren't at all that successful, but at least they got made, and they wouldn't be made today. And The Conversation is a classic case, a disturbing thriller about a professional wiretapper named Harry Call, played by Hackman, who is totally cut off from relating to any other person in a real way other than listening into them over a wire.
Listen, if there's one surefire rule that I have learned in this business is that I don't know anything about human nature. I don't know anything about curiosity. That's not part of what I do. This is my business. And when I'm...
Released in early 1974, The Conversation couldn't have been more relevant about a scandal that would change the course of American history just a few months later, the Watergate cover-up and its story of wiretapping. It was a movie that argued for a person's right to privacy, but not with an obvious, safe, do-gooder courtroom script that you might get today, but rather with a one-of-a-kind mystery led by one of the most unforgettable movie characters ever filmed, The Conversation. We use this word a lot. These are great films.
They are great films.
They stood the test of time.
Francis Ford Coppola had two films nominated for Best Picture that year, this one and The Godfather Part II. And looking at this film again, what you're amazed by is the way that it internalizes what's going on in Harry Call's mind. I remember at the time, big debates about the film, about what actually did happen.
And what did he see?
What was in that toilet.
You got it.
And they didn't have freeze frames on the videos in those days. But the fact that people could talk about a movie and be puzzled by it and enjoy being puzzled by it instead of having it all laid out there real easy for them is great.
This relevance to what was going on in society is very true. I saw this film just having come back from Russia, where I felt I was eavesdropped on, as most journalists were back when Solzhenitsyn was being rounded up in 74. And here comes an American movie that is so relevant to that, and that's what it was like going to the movies back then 20 years
ago. Today, they use the term product a lot. Now, product was a word that was also around in the 70s, but I don't think that people in Hollywood used it so frequently. They talked about movies in those days. Now it's product. It's how much it costs and how you market it and how you advertise it and put it on 2,000 screens and see how it does. And there's none of that buccaneering spirit that the filmmakers had in those days to really try to do something new.
And I remember Gene Hackman telling me after he made that picture, looking back on his career, he said, you know, that one, the lack of success of that picture broke my spirit because he thought it was as good a thing as he'd ever been involved with. But it has lasted for 20 years. It's being remembered today, and the soft, safe stuff, it gets forgotten.
Okay.
I know it was you, Fredo. You broke my heart. You broke my heart.
Hey, Moments when the Vietnam War went crazy, distilled from Apocalypse Now, one of the most eagerly awaited films of the year.
A bigger division now when we talk about one of the most talked about films in years, Francis Coppola's Vietnam War film, Apocalypse Now. It's almost been 10 years in the making, one of the first Vietnam War films conceived, but yet it's going to be one of the last big ones, I'm afraid, to be released. It's the story of a young Army captain, Martin Sheen, being sent up a river to Cambodia to kill a renegade Army colonel, Marlon Brando, who's been disobeying orders and has set up his own jungle kingdom. Now, Martin Sheen is a bit surprised when he encounters the cavalier attitude of the soldiers accompanying him up the river.
How long has that kid been on his boat?
7 months.
He's really specializing in busting my...
Very possible, Captain. He thinks the same of you.
Oh, yeah? What do you think, Chief?
I don't think. My orders say I'm not supposed to know where I'm taking this boat, so I don't. But one look at you and I know it's going to be hot, wherever it is.
Farther up the river, Sheen encounters a warmongering Army Colonel Robert Duvall, who says he loves the smell of napalm. He says it smells like victory. And he also loves to play Wagner over his helicopter's loudspeaker while leading his men into battle.
Put on Cy War off. Make it loud. This is a Romeo Foxtrot. Shall we dance?
So far, the film's anti-war attitude is clear, but it gets awfully murky when Sheehan finally makes it all the way up the river. He's placed in a bamboo prison by Marlon Brando's followers and is lectured by one of them, Dennis Hopper.
You know something, man? I know something that you don't know. That's right, Jack. The man is clear in his mind, but his soul is mad. Oh, yeah. He's dying, I think. He hates all this. He hates it. But the man's, he reads poetry out loud, all right? And a voice. He likes you because you're still alive. He's got plans for you. No. I'm not gonna help you. You're going to help him, man. You're going to help him.
Well, he's certainly been screwed up by the war. Now, this is a very big film that tries to say a lot of conventional things about the war, about the arrogance of our war effort. That part of the film is very colorful, impressive, sometimes even memorable. But Apocalypse Now is also after a much bigger target, nothing less, I think, than a speculation on the nature and source of good and evil in the world, how the war came about. On that score, I think it fails completely. The Brando character, who we wait for 2 hours to meet, has nothing to say, and we walk out of Apocalypse Now wondering, what's the big deal?
I thought it was a pretty good deal. I think that right here we have one of the more fundamental disagreements we've ever had in doing this show. I think, first of all, as a broad statement, Apocalypse Now is a very good film, very much worth seeing. Then to address myself more to what you said, I think the ending of this film is going to be debated for the next 50 years, whether or not the Brando character works, whether the last half hour works. I think we can save ourselves a lot of time if I admit to you right now that although I think the last half hour works, I doubt if I can ever convince you of that, and that the first 2 hours of the film are certainly among the most, consist of some of the most beautiful, heartbreaking, tragic, memorable footage of war that I've ever seen.
And you're referring to things like the helicopter with the music.
Yes,
let me tell you,
right.
Raj, that I don't think it's such a big achievement to make a heart-rending film about Vietnam. I think that America is so conflicted about the war. The people who served feel bad about it. The people who didn't serve feel bad about it. The people who didn't stop it. I think that you can show almost anything to do with Vietnam and people feel, oh my God, the human waste.
That may be true, but on the other hand, this movie is made on such an epic scale. The filmmaking is so good. The performances, particularly by Martin Sheen and Robert Duvall, are so good that we don't see stuff like this every day. This is an extraordinary event.
I wish that I could say that to you. There's a couple of times when my heart was broken in a special way when one guy kills a Vietnamese woman. But other than that, I thought this was the same old standard Vietnam stuff, yes, done on a bigger scale,
so
with a bigger budget. But
the big payoff, and this is the ending is unfortunately there. There is a journey up the river, and we get there. Brando has nothing.
Didn't work for you. It worked more for me. I think that essentially the two of us are representing the two basic attitudes toward this film. Some people think the ending doesn't work, and it's just another war movie. Other people think that it transcends other war movies. It's a little better, a little more brilliant, a little more important. I'm in that camp.
Okay, and I guess I'm saying to people, if they go and they wonder what the heck is the ending about, I'm with them. I wondered too.
And my next film is also about a war, as a matter of fact, Vietnam and our national nightmares about it. It's Francis Ford Coppola's Apocalypse Now, one of the most expensive epics ever made, and I think it's also one of the best. The movie centers around an American Army captain's long voyage up a river to find and destroy a mad Army colonel who's become a sort of god in the jungle, kind of a demented deity. And along the way, the captain, played by Martin Sheen, encounters a bizarre lieutenant colonel who treats the war like a child's game. The colonel, Robert Duvall, goes berserk in this scene as he attempts in the heat of battle to take a beach because it looks like a good place for surfing.
Simultaneous. What do you think of that?
Bill, I think we ought to wait for the tide to come up.
Hey, Lance, come here. Look.
Incoming!
The tide doesn't come in for 6 hours. You want to wait here for 6 hours?
Ooh, you know, Duvall has a real scary, crazy quality there. A lot of us by now, I think, having rewritten history, seem to think that everybody was against the war in Vietnam all along, but that scene shows you that a lot of people thought it was a good idea. I think Coppola saw his film as a journey deeper and deeper into our national insanity about Vietnam, and Apocalypse Now has battle footage in it that's somehow terrifying and exhilarating at the same time. There's a helicopter attack on a Vietnamese village, for example, in which Coppola gives us the sensation of actually being under fire. And you know, there's hardly a subject the film doesn't address itself to. It deals with why we fought, how we fought, who fought, and the effect it had on them and on us.
Well, I don't share your opinion. This is one of the great films of the decade. It certainly started out for about half of it being at that level, and then I felt the film sort of fell apart at the end. I'll grant you this. In terms of its catalog of ideas, this film covered more material than any other Viet film of the decade. I just wish that the ending of the picture, as I've said before on the show, had been a lot better.
Francis Ford Coppola's Apocalypse Now saw the war in almost surrealistic terms, as an exercise in collective madness in which the most insane actions took on a kind of logic and even a crazy nobility. Now, here's a scene like that. Robert Duvall plays a crazy army colonel whose perverse idea of battle strategy is to play classical music by Wagner over loudspeakers as he swoops in for a helicopter attack on a Vietnamese village. That incredible scene continues with the total destruction of a village, and all the suffering and death and incredible waste is so that Robert Duvall's troops can secure a beach where Duvall thinks the waves are great for surfing. The destruction of the village appalls us intellectually, but filmmaker Francis Coppola achieves something else here in Apocalypse Now that's much more complex, because if we're honest with ourselves, we've got to admit that when we watch that helicopter attack, we find it exhilarating, and in some kind of perverse way, Duvall is refreshing too, because at least he has a reason for acting as he does, even if it's a crazy reason. In the middle of a war fought in uncertainty and philosophical murkiness and gray areas of lies and deceit, Robert Duvall behaves with a manic intensity, possesses an absolute certainty about his motives, and through him, Coppola helps us understand why troops can follow madmen into battle.
Well, in addition to all that surreal stuff that you talk about, I think the film is very good in the first half of the picture in doing something else, in showing us the incredible way that we just very casually infused our culture on the Vietnamese. And I think what Coppola is saying is that if we can, as he shows in the picture, go water skiing down a Vietnamese river, have a disc jockey play top 40 hits on a Vietnamese radio station, have helicopters that play music on stereo systems. If we can do all those things, there's Playboy bunnies that come to entertain. If we can put all that American stuff in Vietnam, then the logical extension is you put the bombs in there too. The film almost seems to be saying in the first half that if we have technology, if we have stuff, then we'll spread it all around because everybody obviously wants what we got.
We might as well use the stuff we have it, right?
Yeah.
But I'll defend the second half of the film because, well, it's based on Joseph Conrad's Heart of Darkness, which is about kind of crazy externals, people at the beginning of a trip up a river, and then at the end, the externals get more and more interior until they're inside a mind that's crazy, too, and I think that's what the movie is doing here.
You mean Marlon Brando?
With the mind of Marlon Brando at the end of this journey, because these people start out with all their support systems, all their toys, all their gadgets, their surfboards, their stereos, and the further upriver they get, the more that stuff is absorbed by the jungle. It's like the jungle, which represents Vietnam, says, okay, throw all this stuff in here. Give me your Playboy bunnies instead of your tired masses, your huddled masses and so forth. Give me your Playboy bunnies. Give me your stereo systems. Give me all of these toys. I'll absorb them, the jungle says, and the rest is silence. And at the end of the movie, that's what happens. The entire American presence goes right up that river and disappears.
That's a good defense of the last half of the picture. Very good.
Thank you very much.
Gene and I are choosing our favorite scenes of all time in several basic movie categories. And the next category is action scenes. And I can't think of any action scene in a movie more riveting and sweeping and terrifying than this one from Francis Ford Coppola's great 1979 movie Apocalypse Now, where the music of Wagner plays as Robert Duvall leads a helicopter attack on a Vietnamese village. The thing about that is that it's not your usual action scene, which often to people means a battle scene. These are people who are attacking unilaterally, and that's the terrifying thing about it. And the music, I saw this movie the first time at the Cannes Film Festival with big surround sound, and the sound of those helicopters and the terrifying sound of that music, and then the rockets and the explosions. It was absolutely unforgettable.
Well, using music, I mean, that's the great scene. We've seen helicopters before.
Yeah.
The napalm bombs in the forest that opened the picture, that was remarkable. But it's the use of the music. And Stanley Kubrick has used music very well in action moments. It's a classic example of that.
I've never seen a military engagement in a film that was more unforgettable than that one.
If you know your lines, then you can forget them. No more or less.
I see. But that's what I'm trying to do. Forget those lines.
No, but it's fair to forget them if you never knew them.
That's a youngish director, Francis Coppola, captured on location in the Philippines in 1976, filming his much-troubled and much-praised Vietnam War picture, Apocalypse Now. The movie that footage is in is a remarkable new documentary called Hearts of Darkness, a filmmaker's apocalypse. And this is, quite simply, one of the best movies of this year, and maybe the best movie I've ever seen about movie making. One of the reasons is the woman shooting the documentary footage included in the film was Coppola's wife, Eleanor. Obviously, she had remarkable access. And here, Coppola and his cameramen try to shoot the helicopter attack scene with the Philippine Army copters that are being called away for use in the Civil War that was going on at the same time.
What?
Five? They said two.
Wait a second, stand by. We just heard they're taking away five of our helicopters.
The shooting went way over time and way over budget, creating a scandal back home that made news. But Coppola couldn't quit. He had invested many of his own Godfather millions.
You know, I was financing the movie. How could I quit?
Also at risk in the film was its leading man, Martin Sheen, a last-minute replacement, here shown in improvisational scenes, high on booze. Sheen suffered a heart attack during the production, and in this audio tape made by Eleanor Coppola, her husband is talking to Hollywood trying to keep it a secret.
That gossip can finish me off, because if UA hears that it's 8 weeks, UA with a $27 million negative is going to force me to complete it with what I've got, and I don't have the movie yet.
And Marlon Brando proved to be no picnic either, as Coppola throws him lines off camera so Brando can improvise when he wants to.
I can't think of any more dialogue today.
I don't know if I can tell you how much I enjoyed this picture. You see people really at risk here, big careers and big money on the precipice. Now, I know, of course, that the movie would get made and become a great artistic and financial success, but the greatest thing about this documentary is that while you're watching it, you are actually in suspense. Are they going to finish this movie, or is it going to kill everybody? If you love movies and movie making, and if you don't, I don't know why you'd be watching the show, then you must see Hearts of Darkness, A Filmmaker's Apocalypse. And even though this has been financed by Showtime and has been shown on Showtime, I saw it once, see it in the big screen. I saw it there. It's spectacular.
It's opening around the country, and it was directed by Fax Barr and George Hickenlooper, who had access to this documentary footage that Eleanor Coppola made 15 years ago, and also, most remarkably, to secret tape recordings.
Right.
Coppola did not know that his wife was recording him. It shows a lot of courage and honesty on the part of both of those people to make these resources available. And what it provides for future generations, or as you say, for anyone who loves the movies, is a look at how movies are really made. And we know that Apocalypse Now is a great film, but boy, I admire it more now because you see that these people really were hanging out there twisting in the wind, trying to get this movie made, and they did it somehow, and this is a fabulous documentary.
Well, this is going to be real high up. I'm not going to say how high. I haven't seen all the movies this year. It's going to be real high on my list of the best films of the year. Number one, the best film of 1991, according to me, Hearts of Darkness, A Filmmaker's Apocalypse. That film had played on pay TV. It'll be coming to movie theaters. See it on a big screen. The other thing is, you know who I really want to have see this picture?
Who's
not
that?
Just movie fans. Other movie makers, it should shame them. Because look at the pictures we review.
Might scare them, too.
Look at the pictures we review week after week. Are they even trying to hit one out of the ballpark like this guy? Are they shooting from their heart? Forget it.
That's right.
Our next film is Francis Coppola's One from the Heart, a love story from the director of such films lacking in love as the two Godfather pictures and Apocalypse Now. This film has been released with a torrent of publicity about the thinly stretched finances of its director, Coppola, and how it was filmed entirely on a set that Coppola built in his Hollywood studio when he could have easily gone to Las Vegas itself. But all of that has nothing to do with the quality of this movie, which in a word is uneven. The film is set in Las Vegas, and it's the story of a young couple, Terry Garr and Frederick Forrest. She's a bored travel agent with dreams of traveling to exotic lands. He runs a desert junk shop, and they're both deeply mired in terminal boredom and dissatisfaction with each other on the anniversary of their 5 years together.
You know, if this is it, it's not enough.
What do you want from me? I'm not the social director around here. I'm not here to entertain you.
I know. All right. Don't get upset.
I'm not upset. Just sometimes you piss me off, that's all.
Well, sometimes you piss me off, too, when I don't start yelling at you.
I'm not yelling. I'm not even shouting.
Hank, let's not fight.
Please.
Please. Honey, let's just promise to never, ever fight ever again, okay?
You promise?
I promise. Seal it with a kiss.
But fight again they do, and a few minutes later, in fact, and they walk out on each other, each pursuing a fantasy romance, a Mr. Right, a Miss Right. Terry Garr finds her dream in the form of Raul Julia, who told her he was a singer, but she finds out differently when they meet for the second time.
I'm glad to see you.
I'm glad to see you, too.
To Bora Bora and other romantic places.
Listen, isn't that my club sandwich there?
Yeah. Not anymore.
As for Frederick Forrest, he finds his dream in a tough circus performer played by Nastasia Kinski.
Got a light?
Sure.
Got a nice build. I mean, I think you're a nice person. Got beautiful, beautiful eyes. You got a lovely family.
She's very exciting in this movie. You want to meet me 9 o'clock at the Fremont is not a line that should generate that kind of response. She's something. I've seen One from the Heart twice now, and I liked it more the second time, as its two lead characters finally got to me after two viewings. The first time I saw the picture, I thought they were simply deadhead adults, totally overpowered by director Coppola's fascination with the neon Vegas set he built. The second time I saw the picture, I had to acknowledge the sincerity and evocative power of their dreams. But unfortunately, together, they're still not much of a couple. So, a very mixed review from me, but would I recommend the picture? Yes, because I want to say, see it twice. There's a little bit more to One from the Heart than what comes across at first viewing.
Well, I've only seen it once, so maybe that's my problem. I felt, as you said, that the sets and the production totally overwhelmed the people to the point where there wasn't a moment in this film when I really cared about the two primary characters.
Roger, I'm in a tough position because I am going to recommend the film. I must say, the dreams are so strong, the two dream characters, the relationships, that I think that shows us, if this film is also about, like Shoot the Moon, the breakup of a relationship, breakup of a marriage, we see the pull. We see the chase of the fantasy figure.
You know, I think what Coppola was trying to do here was to recreate the kind of fantasy and magic that Hollywood had in musicals and other kinds of movies in the 30s and 40s, total fantasies. But in those films, the actors were part of the fantasy. The Astaires and the Rogers and the Eleanor Powells were part of the fantasy. Here, we have mundane characters, ordinary people, and then a fantasy. The juxtaposition doesn't work, and the fantasy totally overwhelms them.
That same year, 1983, Cruise stepped up in class in another teenage film, Francis Coppola's The Outsiders. He had a small role as one of the kids from the wrong side of the tracks in this story of haves and have-nots.
Hey, tell me, pony boy, what's it like being a hero, huh? Or what? A hero, man, you know, like a big shot even.
Rumblefish is the latest film from director Francis Ford Coppola, who unfortunately seems to have lost his way since the high points of his career, the two Godfather movies and the first half of Apocalypse Now. Rumblefish tells the story of problem kids from broken homes, particularly one young kid named Rusty James, played by a young actor Matt Dillon. Rusty James doesn't really know his mother. His father is an alcoholic, and his older brother is a suicidal motorcycle-riding gang member. That's why Rusty James has difficulty relating calmly to his girlfriend, played by the young actress Diane Lane. The movie was filmed in black and white.
I love you, but I gotta run. Okay? All right, I'll see you later.
Yeah.
Now, in addition to his parents, that cool brother of Rusty James is also a problem. In this scene, the two brothers talk about their troubled past. Rusty has a fear of being left alone.
I can't stand being left alone, man. I really can't. I feel like I'm getting choked. You know what I mean? I feel like I'm being choked. See, you can deal with it.
See, when you were 2 years old, I was six. Your mother decided to leave. You know, she took me with her. When the old man found out, he went on a 3-day drunk. He told me it was the first time that... He told me it was the first time he ever got drunk. He took me back to the old man. He sobered up enough to go home, I suppose. That's how you developed your fear of being alone.
You never told me that before.
Hold it right there a sec, man. Just a sec.
A couple of young actors playing tough guys. Rumblefish is a heartfelt movie, and the black and white photography is moody and attractive, depicting kind of a smoky hell, and it has an interesting soundtrack too. But the story comes across, for me at least, as much too mannered, too artificial for all of its gutty realism of contemporary kids and their contemporary problems. Matt Dillon gets to be boring after a while, frankly, with his James Dean impersonation. Mickey Rourke, the older brother there, whispering, he gets kind of annoying too with all the whispering. And Dennis Hopper is really annoying as the father, the drunk father. In short, there are plenty of kids in the world who have a tough time growing up, and you really do feel sorry for them. But there's a hip smugness to the Matt Dillon character in Rumblefish, and sorry, but I never felt sorry for him at all, and that's why I didn't like the movie.
Well, first of all, his hip smugness, I think, is his defense mechanism. But secondly, and I did like the movie, and I admired it as a very interesting offbeat experiment by Coppola, I think you're missing the whole point of you reviewing the story and saying, well, we can't really feel sorry for these kids, the other kids with tough problems and so forth. This movie is a stylistic exercise in black and white. Coppola calls it an art film for kids, an art film for teenagers, and I think that's how it plays, kind of like Diva crossed with the Blackboard Jungle with all of those
clouds scuttling across the sky in fast motion, well, and all the dramatic shots. That's how it plays. It's atmosphere and mood and behavior, and that's what it's about. Yeah, but Roger, I reviewed the atmosphere, the soundtrack, and the music, and I liked every one of those things. Okay. And yet, it still wasn't enough for me, this kid, that he also included actors in there, and he also included a story in there. And just to focus on one aspect of the film isn't enough for me. He can call it whatever he wants to, but I'm looking at the whole picture there, and I found that kid repellent, when by all rights, I should really feel for his story. Weren't you touched with a kind of... by anything, not even the three examples I was going to give. You were totally untouched. Even when, you know, you just said the part of the word "his," and that's when I checked out. Well, I guess I'm not going to be able to convert you, but I don't know. I thought that it was a really interesting film, and I interesting thought that it looking, interesting looking, you're absolutely okay, right. Okay, and it would be great to have on your cassette at home and to listen to that music, but never mind. Okay. I'll get back to you on that one.
The film is Francis Coppola's The Cotton Club, one of the most eagerly awaited films of the holiday season, a film that has had a much reported on troubled production history. But who cares about that? It's the movie that counts. And The Cotton Club, the movie, turns out to be a fine but wildly uneven picture with a lackluster star at its center and a story, I think, that doesn't really kick into high gear until the second hour. In reality, The Cotton Club, the nightclub, was a celebrated Harlem hangout where the greatest black entertainers of the day, Duke Ellington, Cat Calloway, Lena Horne, and many others, performed for exclusively white audiences that included the most notorious gangsters and show business stars of the day. And grafted onto that reality about the club is this story of how a white cornet player, Richard Gere, becomes adopted by mobster Dutch Schultz when he saves Schultz's life at the club.
Am I right?
Forget it.
I got a myrtle here.
Vera, as in very, very. Cicero, like in Latin. Did you ever study Latin?
I was an altar boy.
Myrtle, huh?
Yeah.
Is that your birth name?
It's an altar boy.
I would.
I believe it.
Is she wearing a girdle?
Oh, yeah. Oh, that's a lovely
time. Well, thank you. Thank you very much. You going with anybody?
Yes. Bring a mustanger, honey. What are they doing?
Good behaving, Mr. Miss.
Wanted by the police, Mr. Cicero.
Good night, fellas.
Watch out! Watch out!
What the hell is this?
Some people don't like
me. Who the hell are you anyway?
I'm your Dutch uncle from now on, pal. I owe you one. Dutch Schultz owes you.
That was James Remar as Dutch Schultz doing an imitation, I think, of Eddie G. Robinson in Little Caesar. And Diane Lane there as the pretty young girl who both Richard Gere and the Dutchman find attractive, and there will be a conflict in the film over that. In addition to the story of those white people, The Cotton Club has a black story to tell of two tap-dancing brothers and how in the crazy world of The Cotton Club, where somebody is always stepping on top of somebody else to get ahead, one of these brothers has given the other brother the shaft, and now years later, after they haven't talked for years, the big star comes back to apologize to his brother. That's one of the very best scenes in the movie. That was Gregory Hines apologizing to his real-life brother there, Maurice Hines, and that's one of a number of great moments in this film, which was just too short for me, too short to tell all of its stories completely. And another problem is Richard Gere, who I find utterly lacking in humanity on the screen of late. He's a real drag in this picture, and yet for every problem with The Cotton Club, I can name at least two or three things that are terrific about it. The show production numbers, a raft of fine supporting performances, including one great imitation of Cab Calloway, a magnificent sequence involving Gregory Hines, tap dancing, the mobsters, gunfire, and a provocative theme in the film about how people get ahead in America, often by stepping on top of other people. So I did like The Cotton Club. I just wish there were more of this movie and less of Richard Gere.
Well, Richard Gere didn't bother me. I thought he was just fine in the picture, but I agree with you that there should have been a lot more of the movie. In fact, another hour, and they say they have 200,000 extra feet of the film.
I see every foot.
Let's put some of it in. They probably thought, well, it's too long. We won't be able to get it into theaters if we make it that long. But what it has
is the same kind of richness that The Godfather had, mm-hmm. the same kind of complexity, mm-hmm. and the same kind of nostalgic sort of elegiac memory feeling. I mean, mm-hmm. you have the notion here that years are passing and that lives are being mm-hmm. made, that some people are being successful, that other people are failing, that it all happens with this yeah. musical background, which was the same thing that Coppola had in The Godfather, a real epic story, wonderfully told, great character performances by another dozen actors now, that we haven't mentioned yet.
You know what's going on in the movie industry right now? They're all afraid of the three-hour film. Mm-hmm. The right stuff bombed, and everyone's saying, keep it to 2 hours, keep it to 2 hours. And I'll tell you that what we really, it's a terrible development. And I think that, I hope that in some way that this film gets released in a much fuller version, a three-hour version, or even longer.
You know, two guys you got to mention are Bob Hoskins and Fred Gwynne. Plays a little club owner. He was in The Long Good Friday, that great British crime picture. Fred Gwynne is a real tall kind of monster sort of guy who plays a character named Frenchy, and their relationship in the movie, I think, is as good as anything else. That funny kind of love-hate.
The other thing I like is that it's a musical with a social conscience. And the last one we saw was Cabaret, one of the great American musicals. Yeah. This is another one in that way, because this film has a lot to say about segregation, racism, and the way people have to struggle in the very classes.
It's got an edge.
Very hard edge.
It's got a cutting edge.
The next choice from both of our top 10 lists is Francis Coppola's The Cotton Club. It's the story of white gangsters and black entertainers all struggling to get ahead. The black story is more interesting, though, because we've seen it less. And one of the film's bright spots is a dazzling performance by Larry Marshall playing the role of Cab Calloway, who did perform regularly at the Harlem Cotton Club in the 1920s. That was Richard Gere there, who's a cornet player, and he turns into a movie star. He has an easier time than the black performers in this film. The Cotton Club is full of entertainment like that, but overriding it all is the story of people trying very hard to get ahead any way they can. Some of these stories aren't pretty, but they're just as real and as entertaining as the musical numbers themselves. And what I like best about this film is that an entire world has been created, and we feel its richness and its completeness in every scene. It's just not one person trying to do one thing and doing it by the time the movie's over. And that's a great accomplishment in creating an entire world for any film.
I agree with everything you've said.
Thank
you. Oddly enough, I think it's a great movie. I enjoyed it too. You know, the one thing that bothers me, though, is that I've been reading so much about how much it costs, and all the coverage of whether or not it will make its money back, and whether Robert Edwards or Francis Coppola was the one who was in charge of running up the bills. This movie is going to get lost in the middle of all that ridiculous financial reporting. Yeah. It's a fun movie. Yeah. Why can't people just go to it and have a good time without bringing in their balance sheets?
And this is one time the press is at fault, because it's a lot easier to write stories about numbers than it is about art.
You're absolutely right.
And so that's
right.
why the number story is getting the attention the film should be.
Okay,
good for
so
you.
So we say it's on our list of good movies. We don't care how much it costs.
The first film, Peggy Sue Got Married, is one of the most eagerly awaited films of the year, opening shortly around the country, and it's a film that is going to remind a lot of people of Back to the Future. But that's okay, because Back to the Future, just like Peggy Sue, in my opinion, was a terrific film with an absolutely mesmerizing subject, reliving one's past. That's what happens to Kathleen Turner's character when she bumps her head at that high school reunion. Suddenly, she finds herself transported back 25 years to her high school days, only she has the sensibility of someone from 1986. That's why, after she settles into this wild situation, she's able to say things she didn't say years ago and wish she had, especially to her parents.
You know, Mom and Dad, you are the best parents a girl could ever have. I'm really going to try and behave myself.
Sure you will.
Come on, Mom, sit down.
You want me to sit? I mean, isn't this great? Just all of us here together? Really
love me. That's a sweet scene. The darker center of the movie is her relationship with a young man who will become her husband, a marriage she knows will end in divorce. Still, she likes the guy a lot.
Miss John, let's make love.
What? You mean sex? Intercourse. You want to have intercourse? Last week, and you said,
What time is it? Holy cow. It's late. Real late. Come on! What is this? What the hell is going on, Peggy Sue? One week you say if you love me, you won't. The next week you say if you love me, you will. That's a guy's line.
That's the first time, I think, in history where a guy wanted his car to start on a date. That was Nicolas Cage as her boyfriend, and I can't say enough about his performance. He's just not a macho guy. He's a guy who's all confused and adolescent, just the way all adolescents are. And, of course, how can you complain about anything Kathleen Turner does? She, along, I think, now with Deborah Winger, are the two actresses of the moment. She turns in one performance better than the next. And Turner, who so often has played a sultry woman, is dead on. And you could see it there as a wide-eyed, innocent, girlish woman, actually, exhilarated by her situation, but also, as we see, saddened that she seems powerless to do anything about it. I love Peggy Sue Got Married. This is a light but deeply felt picture by Francis Coppola, taking a classic situation, I guess something that we'd all love to do, time travel, and making a classic movie. I want to see this film again. I will see it again very soon.
I think it's one of the best films of the year.
Sure
I sat in the theater, and I was absolutely entranced by this movie, and you did compare it to Back to the Future, as a lot of people will.
Right.
But if you think about it, really only the gimmick is the same.
That's
going
correct.
Back 20 or 25 years to another time, the basic premise is totally different. It's totally different for a teenager to go back and meet his parents when they were teenagers.
Yes.
And for an adult to go back and be herself as a teenager in that old situation. I wish I could do it all over again, knowing what I know now. She
right.
knows she's going to marry this guy she's making out with. She knows what will happen to her parents, and yet they mm-hmm. are blind. They can't see that she's different. They still think she's the same teenager,
right.
and it's just filled with one great situation after another based on that premise.
I think this is a classic theme. It's a Wonderful Life with Jimmy Stewart going back and seeing his life. I don't know if you can pick anything more emotional if you think about it. We all would like to visit people that we miss, whether it's grandparents or parents. We all would like to correct mistakes that we made. We would all like to have a second chance. I mean, it's a classic movie situation. He's made Francis Coppola a classic movie. It's marvelous.
Yeah, you know what else it is? It's the most beautiful high school reunion movie because that's what you go to a high school reunion for. You see some old bald guy like you, for example, and you say, gee, I remember when he had hair. Well, in this movie, she goes back and she sees them all as they were then. And that's so it is. It's really a good movie. Tucker is played in the movie by Jeff Bridges, who enthusiastically describes his dream to his family.
Gallup took a poll last week to find out what Americans want most when the war is over. 87% of the people in this country said the first thing they want is a new car. Now, which do you think the public would rather buy? The same old models Detroit has been giving us before the war, or the car of tomorrow, today.
Whoa!
At first, things go well as Tucker finds a surplus War Industries plant in Chicago to build his car.
The biggest damn plant in the whole world, and we're the ones who got it.
Oh, that's wonderful.
All we need now is $15 million in a car.
Oh, that's...
Tucker gets in trouble after Detroit's big three use their political clout to shut him down.
Tucker, don't go home. There's two police cars waiting for you. They're going to arrest you.
Don't go home.
And this you won't believe. Outside the police station, maybe there's 50, 100 reporters, photographers, newsreels even. They're going to drag you out with leg irons.
The movie ends with Tucker's defense of himself at his jury trial for fraud.
But if big business closes the door on the little guy with a new idea, we're not only closing the door on progress, but we're sabotaging everything that we fought for. Everything that the country stands for. And one day we're going to find ourselves at the bottom of the heap instead of king of the hill, having no idea how we got there, buying our radios and our cars from our former enemies. I don't believe that's going to happen. I can't believe it, because if I ever stop believing the plain old common horse sense of the American people, there's no way I could get out of bed in the morning.
And we learn the whole heartbreaking story of how Tucker really did deliver on his promise to deliver 50 of these cars, 46 of which are still on the road, but nevertheless was never able to keep going because the big three
didn't want that competition. There was a lot I enjoyed about Tucker, and especially the look of those sleek and handsome old classic automobiles. But the movie as a whole was a disappointment. Francis Coppola, who usually pumps so much energy into his films, never really convinced me this time that he knew why he was really making this one. The movie is not a detailed examination of the automobile's history, nor does it have much psychological insight into Tucker, the man. He remains just kind of a cheerful enigma. Nor does it ever really even make the conspiracy against Tucker very exciting. It's all kind of sad and weary. It's been said that Tucker is a somewhat autobiographical film for Coppola. It's a movie about a visionary with a large family and devoted friends and grandiose plans that are shot down by the establishment, and it's impossible not to see the parallels with Coppola's own attempts to run his own Hollywood studio. Maybe that's the problem with the film. Tucker was too close to Coppola for Coppola to see him clearly, and the fate of his dreams was too depressing to inspire much energy.
Well, I don't know. That's speculation, but I would agree with you that the film had a disappointment quality for me. I was caught up as the film progressed, and he developed his car, and Coppola shoots in a very exciting, fluid way, breaking through some walls and making some leaps in editing that are very exciting. And so we get caught up visually, as well as in the story pacing, with the development of the car. However, you pick on two major flaws. One, we don't know who Preston Tucker is. We don't know who he is, other than the fact that he wants to build a car. There should have been more private time with him and who this guy is, rather than just what he wants to build. And second, the film is really a letdown, because we know that the big three are going to crush him. It's obvious. They're sinister. We know that the Tucker automobile does not exist today. It did not become a hit. And so the surprise element of the film is totally lacking, and we're shut down.
So well, I
it's
guess
a beautiful film.
It is.
I didn't mind watching it, but when the Coppola name is there, you expect a little bit more.
He makes a film. He cannot make a film that is not compelling to watch.
Visually.
But to watch visually. But at the same time, this time he did not make a film that was compelling.
And I think the real thing is, who is Tucker? I don't know.
It's because New York Stories, as Gene said, is an anthology of three short films about New Yorkers, directed by Martin Scorsese, Francis Coppola, and Woody Allen. And because each film stands alone with a different director, screenplay, and cast, we're going to review them that way as three different films. Mm-hmm.
The second New York story is by Godfather director Francis Coppola, and his story is a child's tale called Life Without Zoe, which updates the old New York story of Eloise, the spoiled little rich girl who lived in the Plaza Hotel. In this case, the time is now. Zoe lives at the Sherry Netherland Hotel, and her best friend, because her parents are frequently out of town, is a hotel butler.
Smell that hot chocolate. Come on, it's just like you like it. Sugar and sweetened low. One and one.
Yeah. Don't want to go to school. I don't feel good.
You don't want... You know, maybe you have the flu. It's going around. Let me... Ooh, I burned my hand. Quick, get the salve. Ooh, please, help.
When Zoe's mother does return home from a trip abroad, she finds that her daughter is having a wild party for friends.
So, is this what your father calls sophisticated? 12-year-old girls drinking strawberry daiquiris and reading Paris Vogue.
Mom, what are you doing here?
It's a warm welcoming. I'm your mother. This is my bedroom. And these are my earrings.
That's Talia Shire as the mother. Life Without Zoe is a very lightweight story by Coppola. He clearly intended to be the movie equivalent of a children's book. In fact, the titles of the thing are filmed by Francis. So he's really trying to tell a child's story. And the pictures are beguiling. But we're not sure what the story is about. Zoe is spoiled, but that's because her parents ignore her. The film needs more time, I think, with the parents, or at the very least, more time with the person who I thought was the most interesting character in the story, the butler. I think it could have been just about the butler and the girl relationship. As it stands, it's a well-directed but empty story, and I have to give it thumbs down.
Thumbs down for me, too. Don Novello played the butler, and it had been the butler's story, how he deals with these rich people, that could have been fun. This movie is totally unfocused. Mm-hmm. The relationship between Zoe and her mother, Talia Shire, is utterly confusing.
It's not on the screen.
It's not. Well, first of all, there's a lot of tension, and she's a mean woman,
and then
later
she's gone.
On they're best friends. We can't understand that either. Frankly, I was shocked. I would have thought that given the chance to make a short film, these directors who always are forced to work at 2 hours length would have had something they were saving up to really do something special with. And this is the sort of thing you'd see, you know, in some student film festival, except for the production value.
Well, that's what catches you, is visually it's interesting. I mean, the guy doesn't know how to shoot an uninteresting shot, even the last shot in the picture.
Yes, but he sure does know how to tell an interesting story.
In that case,
time.
You're right. Our first film is The Godfather Part III, and in a nutshell, this picture is not in the same league as the first two films in the series, but how many other movies are? There are problems with this new film, but it still has impressive strengths, returning to the story of Michael Corleone, now trying to achieve some respectability in his late middle age. The film opens with him receiving an honor from the Vatican after making a $100 million contribution. That's the sort of thing that Corleones do. His estranged former wife, Kay, played by Diane Keaton, is onto his game. They have a most exciting relationship in this film. She knows Michael better than anyone, and they still love each other.
I came here to protect my son. I didn't come here to see you disguised by your church. I think that was a shameful ceremony.
I spent my life protecting my son. I spent my life protecting my family.
They're exciting together. Later at the same party, Michael's peaceful, respectable life is torn apart by his nephew, Vincent, the illegitimate son of the late Sonny Corleone. Remember him, played by James Caan. Vincent, played by Andy Garcia, gets into a fight with mob boss Joey Zaza, played by Joe Mantegna.
So, what's the trouble between you and Mr. Joe Zaza?
Just trouble. I'll take care of it.
It's foolish of you.
Foolish of me? He's a little foolish to this guy, don't you think? Right? Right!
Temper like his father.
Vincent turns out to be a key character in the movie, taking over the role of muscle man for the Corleone family when battle is joined with Joey Zaza. Michael, in the hospital, recovering now from a diabetes attack, tells Vincent to cool it with his hitman mentality.
I command this family, right or wrong. It was not what I wanted!
In A Tale of Forbidden Love, Vincent ends up becoming romantically involved with Michael's daughter, Mary. His first cousin, played by director Coppola's real daughter, Sophia. The other story point in the film is Michael's involvement with the Vatican Bank, which has just suffered a big loss.
This deal with the Nobiliari can make you one of the richest men in the world. Your whole past history and the history of your family will be washed away.
Well, the intrigue in Rome is a little melodramatic, to say the least, but so is the spirit, of course, of this entire saga. A bigger problem is the casting of Sofia Coppola, who is out of her acting league here. She's supposed to be Andy Garcia's love interest, but no sparks fly. He's more like her babysitter. And the very last scene of the film with some bad makeup on Al Pacino is an embarrassment. But on the positive side, there is so much to treasure here. Big themes of family and destiny, the rare pleasure of picking up characters' lives, the punishment of Michael Corleone seeming utterly appropriate for a violent family man, and that great unfinished love story between Michael and Kay. I've already seen the film twice, enjoyed it more the second time. I'm sure I'll go back again, flaws and all.
It is flawed, it is good. One of the things that bothered me is that the screenplay seems kind of half-baked or half-finished. There's one sequence right at the beginning of the film, for example, where they're talking to each other and it doesn't seem as if what's being said really relates to what they've just been told. It's almost as if the dialogue is put in arbitrarily without really flowing out of the characters in the situation. But on the whole, I agree with you. It's a beautiful looking film.
Yes.
It's a beautiful feeling film. It's great to see these people again. It's interesting the way they dig into the controversy involving the Catholic Church. They get daringly close to real life events there. And I'm glad I saw it.
What did you think of, did you respond the way I did to the Michael and Kay story? I love that story, and I think that Keaton's character is so strong, they could have made her weak. I'm very impressed.
She stands up to him.
Yes.
She says, you're a killer, you're a gangster. He stands there, he takes it, he knows it's true.
Yes.
Because this was a woman who he loved and respected before.
Right.
He took over his father's business.
The key to the whole pictures, the key to him, is when he says to her in the first Godfather family, that's my family, Kay, it's not me. And, of course, the whole scope of this story is that it is him.
It is him. It is his family. Now, I want to discuss with you one of the central questions about Godfather 3, which you brought up, and that is, did Francis Ford Coppola make a mistake by casting his own daughter, Sophia, in the important role of Michael Corleone's daughter, Mary? And I disagree with you. I don't think so. There's no way to predict what kind of performance he might have obtained from Winona Ryder, the experienced and talented young actress who was originally set to play this role. But I think Sofia Coppola brings a quality of her own to Mary Corleone, a certain upfront vulnerability and simplicity that I think are appropriate and right for the role.
It's over, Mary. There are things I have to do you can't be a part of. Don't be your father. It's not your father's decision. It's mine.
Some critics have suggested that Sofia Coppola lacks the extraordinary beauty and irresistible sex appeal necessary for this role, but actually, that's not what Mary Corleone is like at all. She is an average and unexceptional child in a family that she clearly only has a dim understanding of.
You gotta understand, Mary. You gotta understand.
I'll always love you.
She's heard rumors about her father, but she remains in the dark and naive, and I think she falls for Vincent, Michael's nephew, mostly because he's the first guy who's ever really taken her seriously. She's in love with him, but I don't know if he's in love with her. He's such a calculating guy, he might have gone after any woman who was Michael's daughter. My opinion on the Sophia question is that she is not incorrectly cast, and that she adds something to the movie through the very freshness for unstudied and direct performance.
I know what you're saying about her being sort of natural and not the polished bombshell, and that would have been wrong. There is one, a photographer in the picture, who takes care of that role. But at the same time, I don't think it's explained why he really comes on to her, unless this guy is the most venal, craven guy. But look who he's playing around with. He's playing around with the Godfather's daughter.
I think there's at least room for a discussion as to whether or not she's, because so many people have said that that's the biggest mistake in the movie.
No, the biggest mistake is the makeup at the end, wouldn't you? That's a glaring, awful mistake.
And actually didn't bother me that much. Okay. That is not a chance encounter in an early London cinema. The man, played by Gary Oldman, there is Prince Dracula, who has waited centuries for the reincarnation of his dead bride and thinks he has found her in this beautiful young English woman, the fiancée of the prince's attorney, played by Winona Ryder. The relationship between the undead prince and the object of his ancient obsession is at the heart of Bram Stoker's Dracula, a great-looking but somewhat disorganized new epic of the supernatural from Francis Ford Coppola. Lucy, the young woman's best friend, is played by Sadie Frost, who unwittingly supplies the lifeblood which Dracula needs to maintain his strength. And Anthony Hopkins plays a vampire killer whose suspicions are aroused by her condition.
You do not let your eyes see nor your ears hear that which you cannot account for.
Something just went up there, sucked it out of her, and flew away, I suppose.
Yeah, why not?
The movie has all the obligatory graveyard scenes, including this atmospheric confrontation between the vampire killers and Lucy as the walking undead.
Kiss me and caress me, my darling husband, please.
Holy crap! The song is alone! Winona Ryder there plays the young woman who seems to be the reincarnation of Dracula's dead bride, and indeed she seems to feel some special emotion in the presence of the dread prince.
No, oh, I cannot let this be.
Please, I don't care. Make me.
Marry you because I am to walk in the shadow of death for all eternity. I love you too much.
Francis Coppola's version of Dracula does not have a strong narrative thread to draw us from the beginning to the end of the film. It feels actually more like an opera, with a lot of very emotional climaxes and not much logic in between, and that is both a strength and a weakness. I like the way this movie looked and felt, and I like the energy the actors put into their performances. There were times when they seemed to be playing for the audiences in every theater in the multiplex. I liked the production design, the costumes, the lavish and seductive photography. I liked all of that. What never really moved me very much were the characters. I didn't believe their emotions. They seemed to be playing for effect rather than for motivation. But still, it's a good-looking movie. I recommend it for what I liked about it, but not for the rest.
Yeah, and I'm voting thumbs down, Roger. It is a great-looking picture, but boy, that's all I saw. I was interested early on in the Gary Oldman Dracula, the old Dracula. I thought that was an interesting creation. He looks like some kind of weird grandmother with a beehive hairdo, and I thought that's fresh rather than the cloaked prince that we're usually getting in the films. But beyond that opening sequence, I don't think that the Winona Ryder character was very charismatic at all. Keanu Reeves as the lawyer, I thought was kind of in another century. Well, he is in another century, but I thought it was maybe the 20th century. I thought it was very disorganized. And, Coppola is a master of the visual, but I thought it was a pretty empty picture.
Well, the important thing with a movie of this length and complexity is to have a storyline that is clear enough.
Driven through.
So that people know at every moment exactly who is who and why.
Yeah.
And whether we care about them and what's going to happen next. And here you have, as I said before, set pieces in which everything spins around in beautiful pictures
But there's no real emotion.
So then why do you give it thumbs up?
I love the way it looked.
Well, I like the way it looked.
There has to be, thumbs up, thumbs down is such an arbitrary thing anyway.
Not arbitrary.
This movie does things with the visuals of vampirism and the Dracula legend you have not seen done before.
I mean,
the sets, the costumes, the atmosphere, the music, effects.
I know you were bored during it, and I was bored, too. I really was.
Well,
coming up next...
I'm glad you're a mind reader. Maybe you could get a job in the next picture doing your act or something.
Thank you.
Robin Williams has had a lot of success over the years in playing grown-up kids and other kinds of misfits, but here I think he finally runs out of luck. Jack is a movie that never seems to have really thought about what it would be like to be 10 years old and in a grown-up body. Instead, it just takes that premise and throws sitcom ideas at it. Look at this scene. One of Jack's schoolmates has talked him into impersonating the principal. Well, that's a passable comedy idea, but the way it's handled here is all wrong. This isn't a 10-year-old talking. It's Robin Williams doing one of his characters.
So tell me, what happened to Principal McGee? I just talked to him on the phone.
I don't know what happened to Mr. McGee. Mr. Powell?
He got diarrhea.
And that's Fran Drescher from TV's The Nanny. Jack becomes popular with his classmates because he's big enough to buy Penthouse magazine.
And they don't give you no trouble in buying them? I mean, like, they don't ask for ID?
No, I just don't shave for a day. I look like 50.
Only a few scenes in the movie feel like they involve a real 10-year-old inside that big adult body. And most of those scenes also involve Jennifer Lopez as his fifth-grade teacher.
What kind of foods do you just hate?
Broccoli.
Broccoli.
Makes you fart.
Anybody else here hate broccoli? Hands? Yeah.
Uh-huh. Well, it looks like you've got more in common than you think.
Jack could have been one of two things. It could have been funny or it could have been believable. For me, it was neither one. And I don't know who it was made for. Either kids are going to feel uncomfortable, I think, with the grown-up stuff, and adults won't like the slapstick and juvenile stuff. It's kind of amazing to note that Jack was directed by the great Francis Ford Coppola, who was too talented to be grinding out stuff like this.
Well, that to me is the biggest surprise of all. When I saw Coppola's name on it, mm-hmm. as the credits began, I was kind of excited. Mm-hmm. Then I was shocked, because, Roger, I can't point to a single scene in this movie and say, that's a Coppola shot. Forget about the awful screenplay that's involved with. Now, it's well known that Francis Coppola just bought additional acreage for his vineyard, and he's producing wonderful wine there. Nibom Coppola. I like the 84 vintage.
Okay,
but I also have very good taste, Roger, and Jack stinks. It is really bad, and for all the reasons that you mentioned, Robin Williams is just doing his shtick, and to go into the bathos of whether Jack will survive or perish mm-hmm. is really sickening at that point. I think it's a very bad movie.
I wonder if maybe he was thinking of the success of Peggy Sue Got Married, which is about an older woman who goes back and inhabits her teenage body, and he maybe thought he could repeat that formula. But Peggy Sue had a lot of truth in it.
Oh, my gosh.
It was about real life. It was about real feelings. This movie
It was adult.
This movie is contrived from one end to the other. It's a real disappointment.
Tremendous disappointment. Okay, next movie.
A young attorney takes on veteran lawyers. They're defending an evil insurance company in the film version of John Grisham's The Rainmaker, directed by no less than Francis Ford Coppola. And the discovery here is a fresh young talent, actor Matt Damon, who was a battle-scarred medic in Courage Under Fire, and here plays a new attorney in Memphis who applies to work at a meat and potatoes firm headed by a lawyer with ties to the mob, played by a barely recognizable Mickey Rourke.
You get the paperwork on this stuff in my car. Okay. Hey, good looking. This is Dex Shepler. This man will get you plugged in.
The young law school graduate is shown the ropes, how real law is practiced in the real world, by a shifty paralegal played by Danny DeVito. I wish his character were the central one in this movie. He's that much fun.
In law school, Rudy, they don't teach you what you need to know. It's all theories and lofty notions and big fat ethics books.
What's wrong with ethics?
Nothing, I guess.
The young attorney's first major litigation is a doozy. He's handling a case where a giant insurance company won't pay the claim of a working-class woman whose son needed a bone marrow transplant for leukemia. The lead attorney for the insurance company, John Voight.
I'm curious. About what? I'm just wondering, do you even remember when you first sold out?
The Rainmaker is a pretty straightforward piece about legal theory and practice, idealism versus reality. No surprise there. I'm giving the film only a slightly positive review because the script doesn't have any surprises. It's the acting that's so good. With director Coppola, with his reputation, he's attracted a terrific cast and I think a modest story. A marginal recommendation for me for John Grisham's The Rainmaker.
I liked it too, and I was surprised that this movie, unlike some of Grisham's stuff, is really very down on the law. By the end of the movie, you wonder if the guy even wants to be a lawyer anymore. Another thing I noticed, often in a Grisham film, there'll be a really high-priced lead, and he'll be in practically every scene. Here, you have the richness of a very varied selection of character sure. actors. And all of these supporting performances bring life to the story.
It's standard.
I was interested in the machinations of the insurance company and the way that Virginia Madsen comes in at the end and exposes things. She has a real good courtroom.
Okay. Scene.
Corleone.